What is the most sustainable way to implement carb cycling?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Okay, great. So I've recently been diagnosed as sort of beginning on insulin resistance. Okay. And my doctor's an integrative doctor, and she's kind of given me a couple of options. And I just wondered your best input on sustainable long-term ways to change my relationship to carbs, because I love carbs. And she talked about carb cycling, you know, 35-85 or something back and forth like that, and different supplements. I mean, I've been taking like cinnamon, chromium, vanadium, selenium in a cinnachroma that I take. I've tried some goat's rue, and I just got some berberine. So in terms of supplementation and just overall retooling of the way I eat, what would be your best recommendations for me to head this off at the pass and not go further in that direction?
Yeah. You're sort of on the beginning of the way there, right? So we're not talking about an imminent emergency. We're talking about, like, if you could do a slower, better way, you'd rather that than the need to fix everything right now.
Right.
So in that case, then I would hold off on the supplements and try the food approaches first, because I think generally speaking, the supplements are not the ideal way to go, and that's because I think the mineral supplements are fine. And I think cinnamon is, you know, obviously it's a spice that has a huge track record of normal use. So used as a food spice more often, I think that's fine. But berberine in particular, and I'm not sure if this is true of cinnamon, but berberine is basically like an herbal version of metformin. And they both interact by interfering with energy metabolism to trick your body into thinking that you're fasting. And if you look at the clinical utility of these drugs, as far as I know, this is still the case, that they've only been shown to have clinical utility in diabetics. Why is that? Well, it's because most diabetics are not attempting to solve their relationship with their food. They're, you know, going to their doctor and getting a drug for their condition. And so I think what we're generally doing is taking people who are not accustomed to going through a normal fasting feeding cycle, who are not entirely but largely overweight and, you know, otherwise constantly snacking like most people are, and using a drug to basically substitute getting into that natural fasting feeding cycle. And so I think the clinical utility is there. It's clearly demonstrated for metformin, and presumably anything that applies to metformin transfers over to berberine. But I think the results are, you know, just based on what they do biochemically, you're going to get a much clearer experience of the fasting state in the fasting state than you are in the fed state with berberine. So I would try the carb cycling approaches and various other forms of intermittent fasting or immersion into the fasting feeding cycle prior to stacking in any of the insulin lowering herbal supplements. That would be my opinion. In terms of how to sustainably get into any of those, I think that's something that you really need to decide from experience through trial and error. And I guess you may or may not, you know, have, what is your experience so far with trying to carb cycle or do intermittent fasting or any of those other types of dietary approaches?
Well, I've had, you know, I had mixed success. I mean, I have had stomach issues for a long time and issues with my relationship with food for a long time. So anytime I try to really tweak that, it's hard. It's hard for me to do with the intermittent fasting, especially once I get in a cycle where I'm not eating for more than I'm used to. I mean, I'm not talking like every hour, but I'm talking like until like maybe 10 or 11 in the morning, as opposed to when I wake up. Then I don't know. I run into trouble and I often sabotage myself and stop it. So I've tried to go like from say, you know, 6 at night to 10 in the morning or something like that, whatever it is, 16 hours, something like that. And I can do that. And I know I need to be better at being able to count. And as far as the cycling carbs, is it like every other day? Like count? Counting carbs. There's like an app I know I have on my phone, Carb Manager, which I just need to plug into more and get a better picture in my head of how many carbs are in each thing. But so when you do the carb cycling though, because I didn't get a whole lot of detail from her, it was just on the phone. Is it like every other day? Like one day she said you would do a certain number of carbs and the next day you could up it a little and then you go back, or how often do you?
Well, I think that you could do any number of permutations of that and you'd have to pick the one that works. Because it's not like carb cycling has a bunch of RCTs, you know, clinical trials testing different permutations of carb cycling. So I think one approach that I think would work both physiologically and in my personal experience seems to be sustainable for me and some other people would be to set up some kind of rule that matches your carb intake to your physical activity. So I know, I think it was Charles Poliquin, a strength conditioning guy who, I'm not sure if it was him, but who came up with the idea, the phrase deserve your carbs, which basically means like, and it's, you know, some people would dispute the sort of scientific veracity of that statement because you don't have to follow a carb cycling approach. But if you set up the idea where when I get a certain type or amount of physical activity on those days, which necessarily should be something that you can only do a few times a week, then, you know, on those days, then for my evening meal, I'll eat freely of carbs, or I will allow myself X number of carbs, or I'll allow myself, you know, X portion of my plate to be starch or something like that. You know, so as an example of how I implemented that towards the end of last year to lose about 10, 15 pounds, I just basically was eating lean protein for most of the day or lean protein plus veggies at night on any days except days where I did my weight training routine. And so when I went to the gym and fulfilled my full body weight training routine 3 times a week, I would allow myself 1/3 of my plate in the evening meal to be rice. And so that's, you know, you don't have to do it that way, but that would be an example of a, if this, then that approach to your carbs. Mm-hmm. You know, but you could also do something like I'm allowed carbs on the weekend. There's no rule about how it has to be. You know, but generally speaking, like, you know, another way to do that would be a number of steps. So if you have like a Fitbit or an Oura Ring or an Apple Watch or something that's tracking your steps, you could say, okay, on days where I get 15,000 steps, I'm going to allow myself carbs. And so that's a way to sort of, on the one hand, implement carb cycling, but it's also a good way to incentivize physical activity, because physical activity and fat loss are by far and away the two most important things to normalize glucose metabolism. And I would say muscle gain and fat loss. So actually not even just muscle gain, but even just increasing strength and power of your muscles will increase their metabolic demand for glucose. And so I really think that the combination of fat loss, total physical activity, but especially high intensity, so anything that builds muscle or muscle strength and power, and then especially exercise that's in the glycolytic range. So exercise that really focuses on burning glucose would be anything that is very high intensity, but is at least 15 or 20 seconds long per bout of high intensity. And so like the maximal glucose utilization would be when you're doing like 1 or 2 minute bouts of high intensity exercise that you couldn't have done for 3 minutes. And so for weightlifting, you know, if you're doing something that's one, you know, something you can only lift for 1 or 2 or 3 reps, you're not going to burn glucose. But if you're doing like 10 to 15 rep ranges, you will. And then a lot of people in team sports also burn an enormous amount of glucose, like basketball or soccer or something like that, because it's so stop and go. So they're just, you know, all into it for 1 minute, and then the coach's whistle blows and they rest and they recover, and then they're all into it for a minute again. And so you can mimic that by doing like running on a treadmill for 1 minute where you could not have done 2 minutes, taking a 30 second rest, doing that again 10, 15 times, and that will burn a lot of glucose. And so I would, my preference would be to use an approach like that to carb cycling, because then you can very, you can integrate your incentives to pursue body composition, physical activity, and glucose burning goals that cover one side of optimizing your glucose metabolism and tie that to your carb cycling. And it's, I personally would, I also like, I think counting is great, but it's also nice to have like a rule that you don't have to count, you know? So if your rule is like, I'm going to eat whatever carbs I want in one meal on the days where I meet these physical activity goals, then that's also a way to simplify it if you prefer the simplified way.
I do. I like simple.
Yeah. I mean, I've done a lot of counting, but sometimes there's periods in your life where you don't want to count.
Thank you. Okay.
You're welcome. All right. Take care.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.